Now, I discovered last evening that when I picked Nancy up at the airport, that it has been 30 years since her last visit to Traverse City. And Jenny, as I mentioned, is a new resident of Traverse City. They both deserve a warm welcome to this lovely city. So please join me in welcoming them both to the National Writer Series. Jenny Altruda and Nancy Horan.
Well, good evening, everyone, and good evening, Nancy.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Well, congratulations on having Under the Wide and Starry Sky chosen for the Traverse City Reads.
I am wonderful. So honored. Thank you.
And welcome back to Traverse City.
Thank you. It's been a long time. It's changed.
Right?
It has changed quite a bit.
Well, thank you for being here tonight. I'm really excited to talk with you. As Jill said, I love to read, and I read Loving Frank as part of a book club. So I'm just going to pretend tonight that we're sitting in my living room with a glass of wine.
Great.
Talking about books, which I fantasized about, you know, reading Loving Frank, having you there. So this is great. So your most recent book is about a writer.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you are a writer. So let's talk a little bit about that and the exploration of the process of writing that we learn about in the book. But most specifically, I want to ask the question, when you decided to write your first novel, why historical fiction versus doing a straight biography of Frank Lloyd Wright and Mamah? And then again, you know, what is it about historical fiction that really enamors you?
Well, you know, what's interesting is that I was not a great history student at all in high school. And I think that I didn't even think about the Frank Lloyd Wright, Mamah Cheney story as historical fiction when I started it. It was just a story that just grabbed me and shook me. And I had been taking some fiction writing classes, and I thought, this story is waiting to be novelized. It struck me that that story was like a Greek tragedy that just played out in the Midwest. And I decided I had to write that story, and if I had to teach myself how to write fiction while I was doing it, I was going to do it. And as I went on, of course, I discovered the pleasure of research, historical research, and I just couldn't get enough of it. I just dove into this deep vat of history and just pickled myself. And, you know, I would read the corset ads in the old papers from, and everything related, because the ideas of the time, that book was set right after the turn of the century, 20th century, and that period interested me so much because it was a time of big ideas, including, frankly, you know, the automobile, and Frank Lloyd Wright thinking that he could create an American architecture, which was just incredibly, in a way, arrogant to believe he could do it, and yet he did it. Mm-hmm. You know, so it was a fascinating time, and then when I discovered this woman in his life, I really became engaged, because I think that when I was in high school, we kind of got the version of history which was the great men of history, and dates of battles, and, you know, I became interested in the life of this woman, and so that's how I turned to historical writing, and now I'm completely hooked. And honestly, I think anybody who writes books, even if I wrote a book about today, people, you know, in the tech world in San Francisco, I would have to do the same kind of research to understand their world and their language that they speak. So in a sense, it feels like everybody's doing history in some way, except people who are doing science fiction, I guess.
And did your journalism background play into it at all? Your understanding of looking at research and using research to study a subject and bring an objective point of view?
Some. It certainly helps some. I learned something about my own nature. My husband said, you know, you just like to gnaw on a bone. You know, you just want to get down to the bottom of the whole thing. And I found that with the story behind Loving Frank, that it was this chapter in Wright's life that had not been well documented at all. Mm. It had been mentioned in some biographies, but there were so many blanks in the story and so many questions about why they did what they did. And in particular, I mean, the great why question I had about Mamah was, how does a woman leave her children for a lover? How does that work? What's going on there? So fiction felt just right in exploring that because there were many gaps to fill. And in this book, it was a little bit of a different process because Stevenson's letters fill 8 volumes, and I read most of them. And he's written so many books, 13 novels, many dozens and dozens of stories, poetry. And, you know, his presence is in all that work. So there was a lot to find. And then I went to UC Berkeley and read Fanny's unpublished letters. And I went to Yale and read Stevenson's papers. And there was too much information. So you carve it away. And yet there were places to fill where the very private moments are not well documented in diaries and letters, and yet they pop up, you learn about them.
So let's talk a little bit about, before we get, because that's so fascinating to me too, just you've just talked a little bit about the process that you go through in deciding what do you keep, what isn't worth talking about, how do you continue to drive movement in your plot and carve away things. But before we get there, let's talk a little bit about what was the moment of inspiration or discovery that led you to Robert Louis Stevenson and Fanny Osbourne, and that you said, okay, after Loving Frank, these are the people I want to spend the next 5 years with understanding and writing about.
Right. And it really is like inviting people into your home. I mean, Fanny and Louis lived with my husband and me for 5 years.
that must have been very interesting.
Well, I have a dog named Louis, or Louie, a female. We got the dog, and then we needed to name her Louie. But I don't know. I think I found this story, but it also found me, and I think that's true of the first story. You know, I was visiting Monterey, California, and I discovered that Robert Louis Stevenson had lived for a year in Monterey, California. I thought, well, what was he doing there in 1879? And I discovered that he had gone there. He had taken this great voyage across the ocean and the train across America, seeking the hand of this woman that he had fallen madly in love with in France. The trip nearly killed him. And as I learned about this, then I read a biography and I found Fanny. Well, I don't know how many of you have read the book, but Fanny rolled her own cigarettes, she carried a derringer. You know, she was a character so different from him. I couldn't get over it. And I thought, here are two big personalities. And but again, it was story that pulled me in. More than history, it was just this extraordinary story of two very different people who loved each other. It was a thorny relationship. It was complex. It was euphoric at different times. And to me, it struck me that it was about a long-lived marriage and relationship. And I just thought that was interesting to look at. So I think that's what drew me in initially. They're very exciting lives.
Very exciting lives, and that they had the courage and sort of the mettle
during that time period to have the adventures that they had, which we'll come back to a little bit. So once you decided to do that, where do you start? Where did you start to do your research? What is sort of the first thing that you dig into?
There's something that sparks the idea. So, and I can't be sure what sparked the first novel. It was maybe a little newspaper article about this quiet chapter in Wright's life. In this case, it was actually discovering that, walking on the beach in Monterey and near Monterey and discovering that there was a place called China Camp. And it turned out that the Chinese had sort of owned the fishing industry along the Monterey coast there for a while. And there was, at China Camp, there was a little marker there that said this was called China Camp, and it was a bachelor, it was a community of bachelor, Chinese bachelor fishermen. And I thought, bachelors and, you know, what? And so I got a book about the Chinese fishing industry in California. And I bump into Robert Louis Stevenson writing about the Chinese in America in the late 19th century. And he wrote powerfully. He had witnessed the discrimination that the Chinese immigrants experienced. And he wrote eloquently about it. And I was fascinated that he had lived here. And so that's really what took me into the... So it is an idea that sparks. Then I start the research often with a biography. But I have to tell you that biographies are often biased. Mm. You know, there are over 100 biographies of Robert Louis Stevenson. Mm. And really, to distinguish one from the next, a writer has to take a point of view. So I understand that when a biographer wants to do that. But once I've read a couple of biographies, I go to primary sources. That's my process, because I've got to read the letters. I've got to read the works. I've got to read what contemporary critics said about Stevenson. Mm. I have to know what they were up against, what she was up against as a woman. I need to understand the divorce laws and just the climate of the time, the roles people played, the religious attitudes. All of that, I need to really understand and inform myself so that I can shape the story. So it is a slow process of research, but I see pretty quickly where it's going. I see the shape of the story. Fiction comes from the word fictio, which means to Latin root meaning to shape. Mm. And so it is a lot about shaping a narrative. The other cool thing is that I learned that we're kind of hardwired to learn from stories. Recent research at Emory University found that people who got information in story form retained it longer and understood it better. And I thought, well, yeah. And Rudyard Kipling, who was a friend of Stevenson's, said, if history were taught in story form, people wouldn't forget it. And I thought, yeah, I like that. I agree with that.
That's so fascinating, because it used to be, before the printing press, it used to be narrative, right? People passed down their oral histories.
Yeah.
That were more about the lore and the people and their stories to carry on the tradition versus reading in books, like you were saying, about the dates and the people and the times. That really just becomes rote learning versus really engaging with a story.
Yeah.
So when you're doing this and you're starting to see this arc and you're starting to see the shape and shaping these stories based out of fact, how much of a responsibility do you feel, knowing that you're reading writing a fiction novel, to the fact? And at what point do you start to allow your imagination to embellish or to see the holes and fill them?
Well, I like working within the structure of real history. You know, historical, you can do historical fiction a lot of different ways. But it was their stories that pulled me in the first place. The factual history that really got to me. It actually happened. This actually, the story about In Loving Frank, it actually played out. It happened at Taliesin in Wisconsin, the tragic ending, you know. So, I mean, it amazed me that it happened. And it amazed me that Fanny and Louis had such extraordinary lives together. So, I like the facts. And I like the fact that they are complex people and they're flawed. It makes things move along in interesting directions. So, you know, basically, once I have a skeletal structure of facts, I can really add the living, breathing flesh to it. And it's about feeling your way through the journey of these people. Because they were on a journey, literally, Fanny and Louis were, so was Mamah, and she was moving all over the place. So I want to feel, you know, what decisions were made here. And there's that great quote from Stevenson, "Soon or late, we all sit down to a banquet of consequences." Mm. And that's exactly why I love writing historical fiction, because, you know, here is something, a choice is made on this journey, and there's fallout, there's consequences from the choice. And then that requires, the consequences require new choices. And it's very interesting to watch that journey to me. And to feel my way through it. So that's what a novelist does, is, you know, you bring what you know about life to in an empathetic way to these characters. And that's why point of view is so important, because you're choosing whose shoes you're going to walk in.
So that's a very interesting aspect to me. How did you decide whose point of view you were going to write from in both of your books?
Uh-huh. Well, in this book, it was pretty clear in the book about Fanny and Louis that I would do two points of view, not just Fanny's point of view. I had done a single point of view initially with Loving Frank, and it was Mamah's. There was so much interesting material on Stevenson. I could quite easily imagine his inner life. Mm. And with Fanny, she was a little bit harder to construct because there wasn't a lot of material. There was some. But I wanted that interplay and two points of view about what really happened. With the first book, I wrote from four points of view, my first draft, and it was 400 pages long, and I did it from Catherine Wright's point of view, because as the woman who was left behind with her children, I deeply sympathized with Catherine. I wanted to write it from Mamah's point of view to understand Mamah. And Marion Mahoney was a woman who worked for Frank Lloyd Wright, a sort of unsung architect. And also, there was a marvelous memoir I came across by a child who had lived next door, an adult who wrote about being a child next door to the Cheneys and watching Mr. Wright go over to Mrs. Cheney's house while, you know, Mr. Cheney was away. And so I thought that was pretty interesting. And so I had a child's point of view. So I put together this book that had four points of view, and what I learned is that sometimes if you don't do it well, you can really divide the reader's sympathies into four directions and lose the whole attention of the reader. So I tossed 400 pages and I started over, and I thought, okay, how I really want to write this book is from Mamah's point of view, but I was a neophyte novelist. It was my first novel, and I thought, can I have a protagonist, a controversial protagonist, who will possibly be hated by the reader for what she's done? Can I write a book like that and have people buy it? You know, don't you have to love the characters? Well, I was very happy to discover, no, you don't have to love the characters. You can love the book and hate some of the things the characters do. And so I decided that what I was going to do was tell the story from Mamah's point of view, but not judge her. Walk in her shoes. Tell it the way she would have told it. And it had a funny effect. That's what I did. I was really scared about it, but what did I have to lose? I mean, nobody knew I was writing a book, really. I was not under contract. I could do whatever I wanted to amuse myself. So I wrote it from her point of view. And the final book, the way it worked out, is that a funny thing happened when it got published. By not judging her, by telling her story, the judging was transferred to the reader. And readers judged mightily and had big conversations in their book clubs about it and really had stimulating conversations because they brought their own experiences to the whole subject. And it turned out to be a good thing. And so when you ask them, did you enjoy it? They did enjoy the book. It caused one of the best discussions they'd had in their book group. Mm-hmm. But they might have hated this character's behavior or that character's. So it was a sign to me that readers are mature enough to handle a book like that. And it was a great lesson to me in not trying to change the behavior of real historical people who did certain things. Why try to shave off their sharp edges? Why try to prettify what they did? They did some stupid things, and that's history. So let's tell the story about it. Why did they do it? And so that's where the fictionalizing comes in.
Well, and in this book, Robert Louis Stevenson talks a lot about writing, and one of the things he says to his student, Adelaide Bootle, when they're living in Bournemouth is, Adelaide, one of the things you need to know about being a writer is that you're going to have to write about people who are not so good.
Well, that's how I felt about it, and that's why I put those words in his mouth. I'm sorry, Robert. Lou.
And that's the beauty of fiction.
That's the beauty of fiction. But I think he would have approved. He said wonderful things about writing. And, you know, he had a great relationship with Henry James because Henry James wrote an essay on the art of writing, and Stevenson disagreed with him and went after him, and so they had this conversation that they began, and then eventually when Henry James brought his sister to Bournemouth, because it was a place where invalids came to recover, and Stevenson was living there with Fanny, and they became very good friends, and they talked every night. Henry James would come over to their home, and he'd sit in his very special chair and talk about the art of writing. Mm. And so he really respected Stevenson because Stevenson thought deeply about writing. Stevenson has been kind of mischaracterized by 20th century critics as a children's author, which he was. I mean, A Child's Garden of Verses is great for both children and for parents because parents reading it can be entertained by it and also understand the poignancy of the little boy. The writer is describing what it was like to be a child who was bedbound and playing with his tin soldiers among the folds of the counterpane. I'm sure some of you remember being read to from those verses.
That's great. There's also a quote in the book that he talks about when you when you meddle in my work, you muck with my soul, he says. Or did you say that?
I said that.
Right. So my question was going to be, is that, how do you feel about that in the process? And at what point in the process of writing your books do you feel comfortable allowing someone to muck with your soul? Mm-hmm. And who are those people for you that you trust enough to mm-hmm. reveal your work to?
My husband, my sister Colleen, and my editor. those were the people. Well, initially, I mean, my editor engaged with my first book when it was completely finished, because I was just doing that on my own. I was not under contract. But with the second book, she did engage with me. And there were times when I got into a fix. I'd be stuck in politics in Samoa and couldn't get out. and she'd say, I don't think we need to know that much about Samoan politics. And so that happens over, you know, different drafts. Mm-hmm. You see certain things. But basically, at the same time, you really reach a point when you've been working on a story so long, at least I have, where I have certain confidence about what has to stay and what I'm willing to listen to criticism about or where there's wiggle room to change it. My husband really travels with me. You know, Robert Louis Stevenson called Fanny his critic on the hearth. Mm. And my husband is my critic on the hearth. He is an amazing guy and a good critic, a good listener. He doesn't like to, Robert Louis Stevenson read aloud to his wife, and my husband wouldn't stand for that. He has to read it himself, you know. But even his advice, I take with a grain of salt, and I reject sometimes. He's a guy, for one thing. Mm. We think a little differently. But my sister she read so many early drafts of Loving Frank, bless her heart. And she's a voracious reader. I really don't know anybody who reads more than she does. And her, she'd just broad things. She'd just have broad ideas, no small things. And so those are the people. And then, of course, I got into a writing group, which was great. Mm. About 4 years, it took me 7 years to write Loving Frank. And so about 4 years into it, I got into a writing group. And it was begun by the novelist Elizabeth Berg. Do you know her?
Yes.
She's a great person and a great writer, and she really sort of shaped how we would do our writing group. And we showed up every week with work. All of us finished books, and I finished Loving Frank in that group. So I came to trust their input, and yet again, it was a small group of people. Yet again, you have to have nobody had a deeper understanding of where I wanted to go with the book than I did. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I held my ground. And they all do. Everybody does that.
Well, and Robert Louis Stevenson and Fanny, there were a lot of arguments in this book about her point of view on things.
Right.
There was a big section about Jekyll and Hyde and the fact that he didn't see the opportunity for allegory, and she introduced sort of how this could be a bigger allegory.
I think he did
allegory.
See, and he was really brilliant, and I'm sure he was using allegory, but she felt, according to the story, and you know, when you have multiple sources, you have to pick what source you're going to use to believe has told the correct account of it. And this account came from Lloyd Osbourne, Fanny's son, who was present with him and knew the story of what had happened. And Fanny said, and you know, he read aloud to Lloyd and Fanny the first draft of Jekyll and Hyde. And Fanny said, I don't love it. Lloyd loved it. But Fanny said the allegory could be stronger. And Stevenson didn't like that, but then he thought about it, and he started over. So the first draft he wrote in 3 days, 30,000 words. Mm. And he threw it away. And the second draft he wrote in the next 3 days, another 30,000 words, 60,000 words. And he did it with a bottle of ink and a dip pen. So he was a literary athlete, Robert Louis Stevenson was. He was incredible. And, you know, he was a workaholic. He was bedbound a lot. And so because of that, a reader said this to me, and I think she made a wonderful point. She said, well, you know, he was so limited in what he could do physically from time to time that it was a way that he expressed his manhood. Mm. To be able to express himself, to be able to support his family, was very important to him. And it was an emblem of his manhood.
Yeah, it was writing virility. He was...
Yes.
It's interesting you mention his ability to write 30,000 words in 3 days, but there's a lot of talk in the novel as well about him being inspired through his subconscious, listening to his dreams. He talks about his muses being the brownies that come and waiting for the brownies to visit. Uh-huh. Do you have a similar inspiration, or what helps you to get through block, or is there kind of a gut feeling at certain times in the process that you say, I need to go in this track, or?
I have not been visited by any brownies.
Darn.
But, you know, I think he was talking about the unconscious and dreams. And sometimes, I have used dream material, but I really couldn't tell you what it was at this point. But I can tell you when I had the experience of having my unconscious lead me to write about something. And it was for Loving Frank. And it was for the part where Frank Lloyd Wright and Mamah went to Berlin. I knew they had gone to Berlin. And during the time I was writing that scene, or that part of the book, my husband and I went to the Boito's Mephistopheles, an opera in Chicago, and it was fabulous. The costumes, everything was fabulous. And I came home and I said, I'm sending Frank and Mamah to Mephistopheles. And I couldn't even explain why. You know, I just wanted them to go to that opera. So first I had to see, okay, was it even written at that point when they were over there? Yes, indeed. It was being produced in Germany, not in Berlin at the time, but that was close enough that it was happening then. And as I wrote the scene, I didn't understand the scene until I had finished it. And in the scene, they go to the opera, and Mephistopheles is the story of Dr. Faust. And he's an academic who feels that he has wasted his life and he hasn't experienced some of the more lively, carnal, happy, emotional parts of life. And he's willing to sell his soul to the devil if he can say, for just one day, I was truly happy. And I thought about Mamah, and I thought about how that really was probably in her mind. She had not been happy. She wanted to be happy. And it was as simple as that. And I thought that opera was kind of emblematic of her state of mind. Yes. And so that's how my unconscious got me to that point.
That's wonderful. So we've talked a lot about the process and writing about a writer, and these characters are so full of life. When you're talking about selling your soul for one day of happiness, mm-hmm. these are not people who were shy to go after what it was that would fulfill them. when you think about what they were willing to do to travel, mm-hmm. to even the limitations of travel at that time and do some of those things. So here we have very strong-willed, adventurous people to work with, mm-hmm. which must have been a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. It's right. What probably drew them together. I mean, first of all, I think there was a strong sexual attraction, but I think also the fact that Fanny had had more adventures than Robert Louis Stevenson had had mm-hmm. before she met him. And he had longed to have adventures, and he wrote about standing on a bridge and looking at the trains going out of Edinburgh and just longing to leave and mm-hmm. go on adventures. And eventually he did. When he was well, as a young man, he was a travel writer. That's how he started. And he loved that sort of thing. So I think adventure was in the blood of both of these people. But yeah, they were brave. Fanny was very brave, really brave. And so was Stevenson. He came so close to death so many times. And he kept going. And she saved his life repeatedly. That is the greatest contribution of Fanny Osbourne Stevenson, is the fact that she kept him alive. We wouldn't have his work if Fanny hadn't pulled him from the brink over and over again.
Yeah, it was her life's work in a way.
It was her life's work, right. She was an aspiring writer. She had a lot of creative energy. And so she... Henry James said of her, to a friend, he said, if you like the gulch in the gully, you'll like Fanny. And I thought, Henry, that was kind of mean.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because she was so colorful, she was a Western character, you know, in his mind, maybe like some of the characters in his books, the American mm-hmm. women, you know, carrying a pistol, rolling her own cigarettes. But Fanny was, I think, more interesting than that. And I think she was, you know, I think her great art was in creating landscapes. I think she would have been a landscape designer at some point in her life, because she created magnificent gardens wherever she went, and she was moving all the time, mm-hmm. first with her first husband, and then, and always making a home. Making furniture out of logs, you know, she could do anything. So she was adaptable and game. The thing about Fanny was she was game. So she would make a garden, and her daughter wrote about it. Wherever she lived in Oakland, and she had a beautiful garden there with her husband, and then later on, wherever she and Louis traveled in France, Fanny would put in some lettuce seeds, you know. Get something going, even if it was mm-hmm. for a short time. When they lived in Bournemouth, she planted corn among her flowers. You know, her sister sent her seeds from the U.S. so she could grow vegetables. She did it in Samoa. In Samoa, she created a plantation. I mean, just imagine a big plantation. And she was trying to grow crops to make it pay. So. As she always did things artfully, mm-hmm. So I think that she could have done that. She was a perfectly fine painter. She went to study art in Europe with her daughter, and I've seen her painting at the Robert Louis Stevenson Museum in St. Helena, California, and she's a good painter.
So do you think in a different time, these women that you wrote about, particularly Fanny, would have had a greater chance to have been independent and find fame or success in their own right? Because really the book, Fanny takes on a caretaker mm-hmm. role.
She definitely did. She did. Which is a role that a lot of women have taken on in history. Would Fanny have been the artist Robert Louis Stevenson was? I don't know. Her energy, her creative energy was sort of split in a lot of directions. I don't know that she ever, had she had the opportunity to live now, I don't know that she would have been a great artist. So it's a hard question for me to answer. I've read her work, what there is of it, and it's certainly not bad. And then she wrote introductions for a special edition of all of Stevenson's works. She wrote introductions to each book and told stories about what Lewis was thinking about when he started the book or whatever, and where they were when it happened. And they're totally entertaining. And then she wrote a book of her own based on her diaries, The Voyage of the Janet Nicol, and edited it right before she died. And she knew it would be published. And the book today, it's interesting, that book is regarded as a piece of history because very few European or American women were going around and exploring the South Seas at that point in time. And Fanny documented it. And Fanny had access to the women, the native women living on the islands and the missionary women. So she was able to portray what life was like for those women, and it was a perspective that a lot of male writers didn't have the opportunity to have. So her book is considered a valuable source of information now.
When you think about their adventuring, in a strange way, her need to take care of Lewis because of his sickness, was also the fuel for their adventures, because Lewis needed to travel to these climates in order to be healthy. Mm-hmm. And so they were always in search of this, but as you talked about the Janet Nicol and some of the adventures that they had together, it was really fueled by this need to travel,
absolutely,
to stay alive.
Yeah, it was. And so it required somebody like, Lewis said, that marrying Fanny was the best decision he ever made. Now, they had a very complex relationship, but he could say that later in his life. And he could say that because who else would go with him in the way she did? She was really game. And I think that was the quality that he really appreciated. Mm.
Well, and there are two quotes in the book that I'm curious whose they are.
Who said them?
So, we should take a quiz. Who do you think wrote this? So one is Fanny says, "What a thing it is to have a man of genius to deal with. It is like managing an overbred horse."
That is that she spoke herself. She wrote it herself in a line to his mother.
Oh, to his mother.
Yeah, to his mother. And she said, "It's like angling for a sly trout."
Slippery fish.
Because she had to be subtle about taking care of him because he did not like to be pampered. And so she would, of course, a chill was always to be avoided. So she would just quietly put a blanket over his shoulders, you know, when he was immersed in a book or something. She tried, and her son Lloyd talked about this, how she tried to subtly care for him so that he didn't feel too much like an invalid.
So I want to go there. I'll say the other question in a second, but that brings up a really interesting thing that we really haven't talked about yet in preparation for tonight, which is there was a significant age difference between Fanny and Lewis, particularly for the time period. I mean, we did not have Demi Moore and Ashton Kutcher during that time period. So to have a woman who was that much older, and then there are all these dynamics in the book about her caring for him and mothering him in many ways. And there's actually even an allusion in the book that she makes to as long as her boys are happy, referring to Lloyd, her son, and Lewis.
Yes.
So did that come out in research that there was this?
Because that was based on research. It's just that she did refer to her son and her husband to Lewis's mother as my boys. Hmm. So there was, when she was communicating with his parents really welcomed Fanny. He didn't expect them to, and they didn't at first like the idea at all that he had married an American woman 10 and a half years older than he was. But, they welcomed a kindred soul who loved him and wanted to keep him alive. She was their friend and their partner in making that happen. And so, in a way, when she talked to him about her boys, and she referred to her husband as her boys, it was probably to her to his parents that she spoke that way. At the same time, it is an odd little complex wrinkle in their relationship that she was maternal toward him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and particularly after the death of her son, you know, she had left her life in America, a cheating husband, a bad situation, and had the mettle to do that and go overseas. And the price she paid for that, again, the sort of the abandonment or the pursuit of happiness, mm-hmm. has consequences. Mm-hmm. And her consequence was that Hervé dies.
Her youngest child died, Hervé. And it was simply devastating to her. And so, did she feel guilt? Did she feel responsible for her son's illness because she brought him to Europe? I never found that documented in anything she wrote, but how could she not feel that way as a mother? I felt she had to feel some of that. And so, in my view, her caring for Louis had a redemptive quality about it. It was a way for her to keep a very positive force in the world alive and perhaps to somehow deal with the terrible loss she had experienced. And she never forgot the loss of her son. Years later, she wrote, "Today my son, Hervé, would be 40. There has not been a day that's gone by that I have not thought of him." So, you know, I mean, it was an enormous, enormous life. Changing event for her to lose him. And you know, when I first started portraying children from history, I thought about how often people lost their children in the 19th century. And I almost wondered if they had more distant relationships than we do. We're so child focused now. But you know, how did they bear losing so many children? But just observing Fanny's anguish over the loss of her child reveals to me how they were just like us, you know.
Yeah, the bonds were just as tight.
Just as strong.
So the other quote, so we talked about her saying, you know, it's like having this man of genius to deal with is like managing an overbred horse. But the other quote that's the opposite of that is, later on, she says, well, there are worse things in life than being the eccentric wife of a great man.
Yeah. And I said that. And you know, there was a part of Fanny, though she was tremendously frustrated from time to time, because you know, she was caretaking a lot, and she wasn't getting at the creative things. She had a lot of creative energy and her projects were not necessarily respected so much as his. And and where was I? What was the quote again?
So we're talking about
senior,
you know,
moment.
A great, so you know, there are worse things than being the eccentric wife of a great man.
Right, exactly. I think she embraced being Mrs. Robert Louis Stevenson, and I think she had a grand time being Mrs. Robert Louis Stevenson. It was a role that she stepped into, and she absolutely filled in a grand manner, and especially after his death too. Yeah, I think she, you know, she says that toward the end of the book, that there are worse things. And she saw a lot of the world. She met famous writers and famous people. Her portrait was painted by John Singer Sargent, not in a very complimentary way, but...
So let's talk about that a little bit, because when I was reading this book, I thought, well, what... portraiture. I want to see what these people look like. And so I Googled. It's, you know, 2014. I Googled and found the Singer Sargent painting and was sort of devastated when I saw it. I thought, wait a minute, this isn't at all what I expected. Because you think of Singer Sargent and these beautiful society women,
right,
with their
right,
porcelain that, skin and
yes,
their, you know,
yes, Madame X.
And there she is. There's this portrait where she is sitting on a sofa.
She's halfway off the canvas. She's covered in veils. There are rings on her toes.
Bangles
everywhere, which probably she wore. I know she did wear. And she's dressed in a sari, but its covers is she's veiled. And she said of the painting, she disliked it very much. And when she saw it, she said, "I am a cipher under a shadow." And it was a heartbreaking remark, because that told me how painful it was to be second fiddle all the time. I mean, I think it was a hard role for her.
Well, that leads perfectly into a pivotal point in their relationship that you depict in the book, where Stevenson is really cruel to her in calling her a peasant. Mm-hmm. That they're talking about her role and her artistry and her writing, and he depicts her as a peasant, and it hits her incredibly hard. Was that something that you uncovered?
That's real, and that was uncovered in a very interesting way. So Fanny kept the diary of the Janet Nicol, which she turned into a book, and then there was another diary that she kept in Samoa that kind of was found by somebody after they had left Samoa after Stevenson's death, and a missionary woman, I want to say, and when she sent it to I think Lloyd Osbourne probably Lloyd, she said, "I didn't read a bit of it, but you know, I wonder." But anyway, it made it to the Osbourne family, and it was eventually donated to the state of California by Belle Osbourne, the daughter of Fanny, and it was Fanny's diary, and she was very frank in that diary at certain points about what her life was like. It was a wonderful way to hear her voice. It was really the purest voice I got of Fanny's. It was from that source. And she just talked about how she would get so stiff from working in the field. She worked so hard that one of the workers would have to just pick her up physically and move her to the next spot she was going to work on. She really got, I think, bent over a little bit. She just worked so hard trying to make that plantation work. But there were certain parts of this diary that were blacked out, inked out, cross-hatched out. You couldn't read the script underneath. And by a later pen, and a scholar found this at the Stevenson House that's in Monterey, and he became interested, he wanted to publish it. And so he used the technology at the time, which was ultraviolet light, to get at Fanny's scrawling script underneath that was in a different color of ink. And those were the most poignant, private parts of Fanny. And one was Lewis calling her a peasant. And it was the question of who is an artist? What is an artist? And Lewis, I think, you know, in close marriages, I think people say mean things to each other. And he said so many kind things about her that I feel like he was having a little snit fit at the time. But he said, well, you're not really an artist unless you make money from it and you support your family with your art. Well, then that did not include Fanny as being an artist, even though she was a painter and a, you know, so forth. She was a photographer too. That didn't count, and that was hurtful to her. And then she said, "Well," back to him, "Well, then I'm not, you know, what do you mean?" And in any case, he called her a peasant. And he said, "Well, you know, you're a peasant because you care about the earth so much." It was just a cruel comment. And it was devastating to her. And she wrote in a very poetical way. Under the cross hatching, it was discovered, and she said, "I, you know, when I plant something and it comes to flower, or when a tree bears fruit, a tree I've planted bears fruit, I feel like that piece of fruit is a poem from my son. It feels like art to me. So she felt she was an artist, in a sense, and I think she was too. So in any case, she was devastated by that. But that source was tremendously helpful to me in finding out what the tender spots were there.
Absolutely, especially because you had said there was so much on Stevenson and not as much on her. Yeah. And so that when you discovered that, it must have been
And it
like
was
gold.
Really the guy who did it, that scholar, who really ultimately benefited me and other people with that knowledge.
So one of the things, too, that as we're talking about the time period and what was acceptable and what wasn't acceptable, in opposition to Loving Frank, where divorce was depicted in that book as the worst possible thing that you could do during the time period, it seems in this book that divorce was not looked at as a terrible thing, at least not in this circumstance, when we were talking about Fanny and leaving her life in America and getting a divorce.
You know, interesting, I mean, honestly, it was as serious, if not more serious. It was earlier than the time period of Mamah and Frank. Fanny's parents were deeply opposed to her divorcing her husband, even though her husband had been repeatedly unfaithful and he would support another woman in an apartment somewhere. And, you know, she had left her husband before. She had gone for a year and separated from her husband at one point. And yet he, although he was well-liked, he was, you know, on some levels, he was a good man. This was a great weakness of his, and it was humiliating to her. So that's one place where fiction really had to happen, you know. I had to step into her shoes and say, what is it like to have that happen to you? And it struck me that he was the person responsible. He should have been humiliated, and yet she was the one who felt that she had a sign on her back, you know, the betrayed woman. And she's finally left. I thought she would leave because she would think about the impact it was having on her children. Just the atmosphere in the house, to have that anger brewing all the time, that unhappiness, was just toxic. And so that's when she takes off.
So time is marching on here, and we've got to kind of wrap things up a little bit so we can take some questions from the audience in a little bit. But one of the things that we didn't get to touch on, I just want to quickly touch on, is the thematic of exile in this book. And how really in the book you look at exile, not only geographic exile, because they have to leave Europe, they have to leave their home in order to find a comfortable place for Lewis to thrive. But there's a lot of conversation in this book too about emotional exile, and exile from, you know, relationships and things like that. So was that something that you wanted to explore more deeply?
Very definitely, because, well, the little quote at the beginning of the book is, out of my country and myself I go. And it's a line from Stevenson. And I think that for Stevenson personally, leaving Scotland, he always wanted to travel. He wanted to get out of Scotland. He wanted to get away from the strict religious upbringing he had, and yet he was so deeply Scottish. You know, he was so in love with his own culture. And then when he went to, you know, and he could never go back to Scotland again because it would kill him. He had found health in Samoa. So what did he do? He wrote about Scotland. And he wrote beautifully about Scotland. He was an exile, and he had a wonderful memory of landscapes, and he could bring it into his writing, just childhood memories. So it was very rich. When he was, before his death, he was working on a book about Scotland. Fanny left America to come to Europe, and I think she was very comfortable living in America. But she was exiled by an unhappy marriage, in a sense. She went to Europe to study art. And then they lived in Europe after they were married. And his friends didn't like her. His friends were a very intellectual, heady crowd. They were writers, they were editors, poets, and they thought America was barbarian, you know. And she was from Western America. I mean, they, you know, that comment from Henry James about the gulch and the gully was shared by other people. So she was never fully integrated into his group of friends. She was the Yoko Ono who kind of broke it all. And so there were a lot of different kinds of exiles. I think Fanny was always looking for home. It was one of the great realities of her life that over and over again, they'd go place to place seeking a healthy climate, and she'd make a home. She'd plant a garden. So she was exiled from her roots, to be sure, but she was very adaptable. And I think in Samoa, they did find a kind of home together at last. And he was, you know, as I said, he was writing about Scotland at the end of his life, and he dedicated a poem to her.
Yes, so it would be great for you to, we talked a little bit about if Robert Louis Stevenson were the author on stage tonight in this setting, so what would he want to talk about and say about his relationship with Fanny?
So, well, he once said about her, she was a violent friend and a brimstone enemy. And that described her personality very well. But he also said it was the best thing he ever did to marry her. And I think that if he were here, and you know, biographers have really given her a bad rap. Mm-hmm. Not all of them. Some have been very balanced about it. But because Robert Louis Stevenson is the subject of their biographies, she's an annoyance. His friends felt she interfered with his work. They tried collaborating together, he and Fanny, but his friends wanted to collaborate with him as well. But they felt that she was overprotective. Fanny was a smart person. She read Lancet Medical Magazine. She was trying to figure out all the time ways to improve his health. And she knew that when his friends showed up with the flu, he would get it, and he'd get it worse than they did. So she kept his friends away when they were sick, and they did not like that. So I think Louis, in her defense, and he defended her repeatedly during their marriage to his friends, I think that he would say, she was a good thing in my life. He was working on The Weir of Hermiston, which is considered an unfinished masterpiece, when he died in Samoa in 1894. And he dedicated the book to Fanny. And so I brought a verse from his dedication to her. The name of the poem is To My Wife. And he'll have the last word on Fanny. Take thou the writing, thine it is, for who burnished the sword, blew on the drowsy coal, held still the target higher, chary of praise and prodigal of counsel, who but thou? So now, in the end, if this the least be good, if any deed be done, if any fire burn in the imperfect page, the praise be thine.
Thank you. So now we're going to turn the stage to all of you.
Ah, there you are.
There you are. Hi.
We couldn't see you. It was so strange.
We have microphones scattered about the auditorium. If you have a question, raise your hand and someone will get the mic to you. Just say your name and your question.
We have one right over here. Karen Mars. I'm just wondering, are you working on another book now, and what is the subject?
Well, I am working on another book in my head, and somewhat on paper, but I have been touring for quite a while, and for this book, and also the other thing is I don't talk about what I'm writing when I write. It's bad. It's a bad habit for me because if I talk about it, in fact, I have talked to a few friends about what I'm working on now, and I just think I have to shut up and write it. So, yeah, I think the next thing I do, it's not going to be necessarily started by becoming fascinated with a character, a real character, but I think I'm interested in a particular piece of history, and I just want to explore that and find out more about it and portray that. So it'll be historical.
I'm interested in her breakdown.
Uh-huh.
And her terrible depression and him kind of loving her back and healing her, and how much of that is factual and from your research, and how much did you interject into that?
Well, she did have a breakdown. You know, they were very private about these things. It didn't appear in letters for a long time, and then it appeared in a letter from Stevenson to Sidney Colvin. She did have a breakdown in Samoa, and it was dramatic. It was a psychotic episode that lasted over a period of time, actually. And Stevenson said, I can't disguise this anymore. Fanny is not herself. So it really casts some questions in my mind about whether Fanny had had ongoing psychological disturbances through her life. She did have some kind of deep depression after the loss of her son. Who wouldn't, you know? So I started to, in my mind, apply 21st century psychological terms to what was wrong with Fanny when they'd call it brain fever in the 19th century, you know? And I just decided I wasn't going to do that. I wasn't going to try to apply some psychological term. First of all, I don't know enough to do that, and then to try to analyze what was bothering her. I could only report her behaviors as they sort of were reported by Stevenson, the fact she was trying to break away, she was fighting them for a while, and she was out of her mind. So that is correct. At the same time, he was writing poetry to her, and he was, you know, I felt that he was, one of his biographers also approached it this way, that one of her biographers, that he wooed her back from madness. Now, today, in our day and age, would we say, well, I wooed him back from being crazy? I don't know, but when you think about it in human terms, perhaps he turned his attention to her and he loved her as best he could. And he did say repeatedly, all that matters is kindness. You know, he was a beautiful soul. And his poems to her were so lovely. And he was writing at that time, and I felt that was legit.
I have another person.
Dorothy McCormick.
Hello.
Hi.
In writing historical fiction, when you have the facts and then you have your imagination, your fictional aspect, is it a challenge to bring them together to flow right?
Mm-hmm.
And my other question is, what was his illness that kept him out of Scotland?
Uh-huh.
Thank you.
It's not really hard for me to make it flow, really, because there is so much unknown about, you know, there's a fact. Fanny went to Antwerp. What was Antwerp like? What was the school like? I visited those places. And I could see, I could get a picture in my mind of what that school was like. I'm continually imagining her feelings, the feelings of the people involved. I'm imagining the ideas of the time, the other characters, how they might have looked. You know, there's a scene at the beginning where she meets with the director of the school in Antwerp, and I found out the real person who was there. I saw a portrait of him, and I took off with that and described. But she described in her letter that, I mean, her description was that he said to her, "Why were you not born a boy? If you had been born a boy, you could go to the school." But they didn't accept women. And so he said, here's what you could have done. Well, that's in there too. So there's fact. There's imagination about, you know, but it's built on fact a lot. It seems to flow. Your second question was, I'm sorry?
His illness
was diagnosed in so many different ways. And it was thought for a long time that he had tuberculosis. But today, contemporary medical opinion is that he had something else, that it wasn't, that it might have been bronchiectasis. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. It wasn't very clear, but there was one, and he would get differing opinions from doctors. So he obviously had a compromised immune system. The people around him who cared for him did not contract tuberculosis from him. And he died of a cerebral hemorrhage.
I think we have a question upstairs.
Dorothy McCormick. When you have time, whose works do you choose to read?
Good question.
I read so much source material that my free time reading time has been limited. I pick up all kinds of stuff. I can't say one person. I found Jane Gardam, this British writer. I don't know if any of you know her, Old Filth. She's just great. There's a Canadian writer. Can't think of her name. So many people that I really like. I mean, I just read Anthony Morrow's A Constellation of Vital Phenomena that I thought was absolutely brilliant about the wars in Chechnya. I read a hilarious book by a woman called Dear Committee Members. It's brand new. It's very funny and very heartbreaking about being a beleaguered academic, specifically a literature professor, while the people upstairs in the tech department are having spas installed. They're down with crumbling plaster in the lit department. You know, I really sympathize with that because I was an English teacher. I don't know where to begin on that, but I admire so many people. I really liked A Tale for the Time Being, Ruth Ozeki's book. There's another book, We Are All Beside Ourselves, Karen Joy Fowler, which is great. So there's some titles. Yes.
Was Fanny's premonition that something bad was going to happen right before Robert Louis Stevenson died, was that your invention, or was that based on fact?
Her what?
Her premonition that something bad was going to happen.
That was indeed her premonition.
Okay.
Wow.
And so this second sight business of Fanny's, she may have played it up, because Fanny liked to be the center of attention, and she liked to be perceived as having this sort of romantic quality about her. But she did indeed have this premonition that somebody was going to die that day. Something bad was going to happen to a family member, and they thought about all the people it could be, and then Lewis died. She didn't think it was going to be them. She thought it was going to be, actually, he's not in the book, but Stevenson had a cousin who was his biographer. He was going to do the official biography of Stevenson, and he was visiting them in Samoa. He lived with them for a couple of years, but then he was traveling at the time, and she became fearful that something would happen. And she had a premonition about a ship that they were supposed to get on, mm-hmm. and it went down without them. So, you know, she had premonitions, you know. She probably had a lot that weren't correct, but. Let's see, where are we here?
Hi, my name's Heather Kilborn. During your research, did you have any correspondence with any of the descendants of Fanny or any of his descendants of his family members? And then after the book came out, did you have any correspondence or get any input or possibly backlash from any descendants on
your
side?
No, I did get one letter from a person who said that she was from the Vandergrift family, and she was just curious how I had come to know about Fanny, and you know she was interested in, and I sent her a book. But other than that, no, I've not had any descendants from that family contact me. With Loving Frank, there were any number of people who did contact me, people who had known Frank Lloyd Wright. I did hear from some branch of Edwin Cheney's family, Mamah's husband. So I heard from a variety of people closely associated with that Frank Lloyd Wright, Mamah Cheney story, but not this one, just one.
I have a question about the skin color issue, and I wondered what you know of her ancestry and why that was played up in the book.
Well, her ancestry was Dutch and Swedish, and there's Fanny. You know, I think that the standard of beauty in Indianapolis in 1850s. was pale skin, white skin. And, you know, Fanny, I had olive-colored skin from what I can ascertain. And she knew she was different, and she played it up with bright colors, different from, I guess, the other people in town who remarked upon it. The person who was most destructive for Fanny was her own grandmother, who felt that her dark skin was not attractive. And so she would sew a straw hat, into Fanny's hair every day. And Fanny was a tomboy. And she would wear, they were called, they were like long cotton gloves that came up to her shoulder. And Fanny would wade through rivers, and I mean, she really liked to be playing outside, and so I imagine the hat didn't stay on very long, you know. But she got a sense early on that she was not beautiful from her grandmother, but her mother gave her the opposite message, and that's what she did for Belle as well. I think Belle looked just like her.
One more upstairs?
Is there one more upstairs? No? I think we have time for one more. Is there a mic?
Hello, my name's Mary, and you mentioned contractual writing versus writing the first book on your own. And did you enjoy one of those processes more?
Oh, that's an interesting question. they were such different experiences because I met with the Front Street Writers Group today, and I just loved that. They're all such smart kids, and somebody asked me, when did you first call yourself a writer? I had been a freelance journalist, but to call myself a fiction writer, it didn't really happen until I sold that first book. And then I felt like, okay, I guess I can call myself a writer. So it was a struggle during that writing of that book because I was finding my way and taking chances, but there was also great freedom because I only had to please myself. Mm. With the second book, the same is true. You know, I had to please myself, bottom line. I had more confidence with the second book because I had already finished the first novel. I knew I could do it. Yes.
You had said that you had received some letters after writing Loving Frank. What kind of letters were they? Were they supportive or?
Yes, they were supportive. The letters I received after writing Loving Frank, they were from people who said, you know, I am related to so-and-so, or my mother worked for Edwin Cheney, or my grandmother worked for Edwin Cheney, or, you know, they were just these connections, really. And I was gratified that people were open to that story being discussed, and you know, it had not been known and discussed very much before the novel, so it was fine. It was a controversial novel, I recognize.
I love that book. I love that book.
Thank you.